Todd, is there any agreements amongst IIHF federations about insurance coverage? So if, for instance, if a player came on an international tour, for instance, yeah. and did something inappropriate, and that player's family from the Canadian team wanted to litigate against the team from, or the player or participant from the other country, yeah. whether there's a standard insurance at the IIHF level that's...
Not that I'm aware of, Scott. I would, again, I'd have to confirm that. I haven't run into that before, but not that I'm aware of. I can't, not that I know of at this point, but I can confirm that for you as well, but certainly has not that I've been told anyway, so. Okay. Other questions on liability? On coverage, on who's covered? Okay, so reporting liability claims, occurrences may require coverage and should be reported to Glenn right away. So if you have something that you think is going to cause a claim to be made, then you should report that claim and through your member partner, and your member partner will then most likely come to Glenn or send an email to Glenn and say, Glenn, this is a possibility of what's happening. The respondent should consult with Hockey Canada through your member partner again before putting legal counsel in place, because there may be assistance there. Glenn might have some advice. Okay, there may be some communication that's important there. And the occurrence will then be sent to our insurer, so to John Sharoon at Crawford. And John will do one of two things. He will put it on file as record, or he will start an investigation depending on the situation. Okay, and that investigation meaning from an insurance standpoint, they're going to investigate what is occurring and measure our liability, if you will, with respect to that incident. Okay, so that goes to your member partner and up to Hockey Canada, obviously keeping the branch in the loop as well, and then Glenn will deal with it from there. The other part of the liability policy is sexual misconduct liability. This covers liability arising out of alleged or actual sexual misconduct for which the insured could be held legally liable. So someone is saying that someone else did something who is a member to them, then that coverage would fall into place. It's retroactive in nature and it goes right back to 1914, so it's very retroactive. It will also pay defense costs of the accused in civil court until they're proven guilty. So if they're proven guilty, then you're on your own. But it will pay that cost, and it will also pay in criminal court, and there's a $25,000 sublimit on that. Okay, now the coverage for sexual misconduct liability, because it's part of the liability program, it's the same as our liability program. So it's at $20 million, and then there's a $50 million excess that exists there. So there's a lot of liability coverage there that exists. Okay. Any questions? So those are the three policies, and Joe's gonna talk about D&O. So I just want to make sure we're on time here. Joe's gonna talk about D&O, but I'm gonna just go into the claims stuff first. So is there any questions on liability? Is there any questions on AD&D? Is there any questions on the HBT program? Okay, either everybody's asleep or everybody's confused or, well, I wasn't gonna go there, so. So when are you covered? So we're gonna talk a little bit about the risks. So when we talk about the risk, guys, we're talking about hazard risks, we're talking about operational risks, we're talking about reputational risks, we're talking about your risk as an organization with respect to making sure you're being diligent with respect to what you're delivering to your members. And when we talk about the sanctioning stuff, we're going to get a little bit into what we say no and yes to and why we say no and yes to it and why we assess things the way we assess them. And that's all about that process. I've got a little video to show you, I hope, as we move in here. So if you guys could just rewind that. Yeah, perfect. Thank you. So the key question is, what risks do you take? And you know what? We have to take risk in order to make things happen. There's no question. That's, risk is part of everyday life. In the corporate world, if you don't take risk, then you're not going to get results. The key is that we have to control that risk to a certain extent. And that's where we talk about the sanctioning part of things and what is and what is not covered. So a Hockey Canada branch sanction event when playing member teams only. So you have to be playing a member team, really important. Okay, so if you're playing a non-sanctioned team, a team that is not registered with Hockey Canada, then you are not covered. Your members are not covered for those types of situations. Transportation directly to and from the arena venue, which we talked about earlier, and it does have to be, as best we can establish, that that person was driving directly to and from the event. Accommodations while billeted at a hotel during a Hockey Canada branch sanctioned activity. Okay, so you have to be, obviously, on a sanctioned tournament. Anything that has to do with that tournament, you're good, you're covered. In the hotel, traveling back and forth, team meals, anything that has to do with the tournament. And it's important to know that events outside of normal hockey activity have to be or should be approved by your member partner, by your branch. I guess, Sue, am I right? By the branch? Okay, so when we talk outside of, we talk about everything from fundraising to floats in parades to anything that's outside that normal hockey business, guys. It's also important to note that the branch is the sanctioning authority. We are not the sanctioning authority. That authority is given to our branches. So it's the branches that make that decision. Now, we create, if you go to the next slide here, guys, sorry, there we go. We created a recommended sanctioning guideline. And that was done through our insurance committee, our risk management committee. Eddie, you were a big part of that. And that guideline was given to every branch, but every branch took that guideline and said, okay, we're now going to create our sanctioning process, our sanctioning guideline. Okay, so they are the authority with respect to that. Quite often they'll come to us and say, well, should this be approved or not approved? And we will, you know, go back and forth and talk about it and look at parameters and how we want to deliver whatever is being asked about. The key is to reduce hazard risk and increase safety during team activities. So we really want to reduce the amount of hazard risk. Our insurance is meant for hockey-related activity, hockey-related, hockey team-related activity, if you will. It's not meant to cover that concert where you've got 500 people coming in to see a band play. Okay, it's just not meant to do that. So, yeah.
Sledge hockey has taken off in the last few years. And so say if a family, the one boy plays minor hockey and there might be another sibling that is into sledge.
Yeah.
Any problems with exhibition games between the two? They're both Hockey Canada members, I believe. Is there a problem or concern with that?
As long as they're both member teams, as long as your branch and member partner approve it, you're good.
Okay.
As long as they're registered and have paid a premium, you're good. Okay. There's a lot of tri-hockey going on. There's a lot of questions around tri-hockey. We send some stuff over to the branches. There's ways that can be done. Okay. So contact your branch. So you've got a group of kids who want to try hockey on a one-time basis. We've tried to facilitate that can be done, okay? So you can work through Sue and Phil and your member partner on that process.
Todd, can you just expand back on the tournament situation where your team's going to a tournament and it indicates that, you know, the time in the hotel and et cetera is covered in the insurance program?
Yeah.
Expanding on that to other activities that occur. So a team's at a tournament, they decide to go to go bowling or go to do a team activity as a group. Does that stuff continue to be covered, or do they have to come back for sanctioning for those extracurricular events?
Yeah, it's a good question, Phil. I would suggest that if your teams are going to tournaments and they're going to do anything other than hockey business, that you have that approved. And when I say that, Phil, you gave some really good examples. First of all, hotel pool, guys, big risk. Big risk. To do a team activity in a hotel pool with no lifeguards, it's a huge risk that you do not want to take. And there would be question on that if that happened. If mom and dad decide, oh, we're going to take Sarah and we're going to go skiing for the day away from the tournament, there's no coverage there. That's not a team activity. Okay, so those are things you need to remember. If you're going to go bowling, bowling's not something we cover. It's another sport, considered another sport. Okay, so those are things that are outside the tournament parameters. All right, so if you're ever in doubt, check. If you're ever in doubt, check. Does that help, Phil?
That's great. Just on the pool aspect, obviously, you know, we cover them in the hotel for sleeping and yep. for eating and that, but the pool area obviously is not covered in the plan. So if they're going swimming on their own, they're doing that at their own risk.
That's right.
Todd, if I can add something to that, because yes. sometimes we get called from various branches about, hey, can I see the policy? Because, you know, you tell me that I can't go to the pool, but I want to see the policy, because they think that on the policy is going to say pool is not covered. But you will never find that on the policy. It's up to Hockey Canada to say to the insurance company what their activities are. And pool activities is not something that Hockey Canada tells the insurer. So that's where the line is with that. So,
Ken? Oh, I'm sorry.
Can we work through the branch then to get approval instead of coming for every event for certain types of activities? So, for example, we use one of those Top Shot hockey shooting machines mm-hmm. at a lot of events for marketing mm-hmm. to get kids who don't play hockey to just even shoot a puck and hit the electronic net, mm-hmm. right? It's just the inflatable. Can we get like that sort of activity?
That would be up to your partner branch. I can't. That's not my job to answer that. I can tell you that things like that, you may get back that anybody shooting. Sorry, Sue. Do you want to?
Yeah, for the OMHA events team, they won't cover the inflatables because I know that the events team go all over Ontario, and they're not going to cover the Top Shot. They won't cover the games, but I would check with the office because they may have an additional policy to cover that game, because we do an event certificate every year to cover the events team, but only for specifics. Okay, so the inflatables are not covered. If they get damaged, they're not covered, and the Top Shot.
And I can't speak for the branch, and I won't, but I can tell you that I would probably say to them that the shooters have to wear full facial protection. Okay? Because let's face it, guys, if we're going to go beyond our norm, we've got to make sure that we're covering ourselves from not only from liability, but from injury is the bottom line. Okay? So just keep in mind that you're going to, in cases where it's way outside the norm, you may get parameters back from Sue or your member partner or Phil saying, yeah, you can do it, but you got to do this, 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 and this, right? Okay?
Todd, a few years ago, I was with a team in the Czech Republic, and in fact, it was two or three teams did exactly the same thing. They all took a couple of days out and went to Salzburg to go skiing. When teams go overseas, how well informed are they that these sort of activities are not covered? Because I think the assumption would be they are covered because it's a sanctioned trip.
Yeah, and I guess it's all about putting your sanctioning guidelines online. Other sports aren't covered, so the skiing's automatically not covered. Keep in mind when you're traveling as well that the Hockey Canada accident policy is only $5,000. You have to have travel insurance, guys. $5,000 will go nowhere if you end up in a U.S. hospital and you've got a lot of money to pay. Okay, so it's you brought up two really important points, Ken. That number one, know the sanctioning guidelines. Number two, make sure your teams have travel insurance when they're going out of the country. Okay.
I think that's a key one, is making sure they know about travel insurance. We try to emphasize that, but that message can't be strong enough.
Yeah.
We've had a few really rotten situations where somebody's gone into a U.S. hospital and got huge bills. But I guess what we were wondering is in the hotel, they also have fitness, and we know that a lot of our teams are using those fitness things. Are they, well, you know, how would you utilize that?
I think we have to use common sense too, guys. So, I mean, if they're going down as a team and they're being supervised by their coach, like they do with some dry land training, I think we're good. If they're going down on their own and they're going out for a workout, then obviously that's a different scenario, right, Pat? So, but if they're doing it as a team,
yep,
the coaches are supervising, I mean, they would do that when they're at home.
And I just had one more. We get a lot of parent kids games at the end of the year, especially their parent parties. As much as you try to tell people that it's not covered, we know it keeps happening constantly. Associations even approve them.
Can we hold that one?
Yeah.
Because I'm going to get to that in the next couple of minutes.
Perfect. Todd, okay. Todd, Sasha. Todd, turn around. Regarding travel insurance, when you're traveling, it's important that the carrier, the insurance company you deal with, cover sports, because a lot of travel insurance don't cover sport. It's excluded on some policy. So you need to be careful when you pick the insurance company that you deal with.
Good point, Sash. Thanks. Okay.
Saying that, obviously working through BFL, can our groups, if they're looking for insurance to go to the other countries and that, work through BFL to find a broker or find an insurance company that will cover sports in those situations?
Well, that actually, we're starting a new program, and it will be ready for June 1st for groups and sporting groups. So, yes, absolutely.
Any other questions, guys? Okay. So these are just some of the common ones, folks. Okay, this isn't everything. I mean, the list is endless, the stuff that we get and the requests that we get and the stuff we deal with. So some of the common stuff we will say yes to, okay, and I say we. Again, it's up to your branch, it's up to your member partner to make those decisions. Floats and parades, and I put these on here because these are ones where we come back with parameters, where we say, yeah, you can do it, but you gotta make sure that the float is insured. So if that pickup is pulling a float in a parade, you gotta make sure that that person has advised their auto insurer and that they have liability insurance on those floats. We will not cover the float. We will cover our members while they're riding on the float. We will not cover the float. Bottle drives, fair game. As long as it's supervised, it's well done. Some year-end team parties, obviously, it depends on the parameters. Okay, we don't do stuff in private homes. If you're doing it in a public facility and it's a team year-end event, no problem. Depending on the parameter there. And quite often, Sue will look at the parameters of the party and what's going to happen at the party, how the food's being done, is there alcohol being served, and decisions are made around those. Skate-a-thons?
These approvals that you speak of, are they all one-offs? So you have to go through your member partner If you're going to have a year-end bowling party, seek approval?
Whatever. You would have to go to your branch or your member through your, I don't know, Sue, is it through the member partner? Through the member partner to the branch, and they would then make a decision. Skate-a-thons, again, something we will do. Quite often we will say to the branch, no problem, there's going to be non-member kids on there, no problem. Just keep in mind the kids need to wear a helmet, they need to wear face protection, need to wear neck guards and gloves, okay? And there's no sticks and pucks because they're not going out there to play hockey. Because once they go out there and play hockey, you're playing non-member kids, and now we're in a situation where there's no coverage. Okay, so skate-a-thons will work, but they've got to work under certain parameters. Dryland training is a huge world. Yes, we do cover dryland training. And Sue, just stop me if I cross the line here with respect to what the branch says yes to. But dryland training we will cover. Okay, there's all kinds of different dryland training as long as it's within safe parameters. Running a team down the side of a two-lane highway is not a safe parameter. Okay, so it's a common sense thing. Other sports are not covered. You take a team out and play a baseball tournament or football, or that's not covered. Our insurance policy is not meant to cover other sports. If you have soccer balls out in the field and you're doing development, that's no problem. That's no problem. But once you get out and start playing other sports, then it's a problem.
The one that I'm always asked about is using ball hockey as a dry land tool, not playing an active game. I've always said that's a different sport.
Yeah.
But if you're using it to set up scenarios and work through, we are fortunate enough to have a rink in our community that has no ice in it year round, and a lot of our coaches want to go use the ball as a way of cheaper positioning, cheaper. Does that still count as
See, again, you're talking development of skills, and that's different than going out and playing a ball hockey game. But the kids have to wear facial, and they have to, so, and that's part of it, right? They not necessarily neck guards, because they're not wearing skates, but they have to wear gloves, and they have to wear facial, right? So I assume anything to add there? So that's coming from the branch. So it depends on the ball being used as well, so. So it's keeping in mind, guys, there's parameters that are going to be around these things. We're trying to be as flexible as we can, but we also have to obviously protect, on behalf of the members, we have to protect the coverage and protect the programming. So that's really important. Mall booths, no problem. When you're going out, you're selling tickets in a mall, no problem. What we are doing more and more, we're checking contracts. So if you're signing contracts, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute, we sometimes check those contracts. The lower the risk the event, the less significant the contract becomes, obviously. If you're sitting in a mall and selling tickets, it's a little less a concern than if you're in a rink playing a hockey game and you've signed a contract for the season. So you have to use common sense with that as well. Chocolate bar sales, again, no problem, supervised. Those are done all the time. Some of the common no's, parent-child games, Pat, which we talked about. Parents are non-members, okay? So once parents go out there, and I can tell you right now, guys, that once parents go out there and play against the kids, they automatically assume that they are covered. And I can tell you that if something happens, they're gonna come back and they're gonna want, there's gonna be a coverage question there. So you know, that's why it is not covered, so. And Pat, we know they're happening. I mean, we know that many of these things happen, but we try to control them as best we can and bring that risk down, if you will. So. Dunk tanks, obviously, high risk event. Swimming, we talked about. Other sports, we talked about. Rock climbing, zip lining, laser tag. And we get lots of those every year where they're asking about them. And if nothing else, the companies who are running these should have liability insurance. Okay, so we're not gonna respond in a situation where they're doing those types of events. So.
Todd, I'd be interested in comments around coverage and the use of private on-ice instruction, whether it be hockey school instructor, yeah, whether it would be power skating, during a sanctioned practice.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Scott, because we do get lots of those. So my answer is always that if you have a private person, a non-registered instructor coming in, first of all, they should have liability insurance, okay? Because they are coming in on their own. They are not covered under us. They have not paid a premium to our policy, okay? And the other option is that you register them as a coach. Once you do that, they need to fall within your parameters, right? All your training, all your, so they either have their own liability or they get registered. So most of the time, these guys, if they're good and they're well-known, most of these guys have liability when they come in. But the other thing you have to consider, guys, is when you bring them in, you've got to make sure they've got a good reputation, right? Because now, I mean, we say all the time, our coaches have to have speak out, our coaches have to have all the training that we make a requirement. Well, how do we know that person coming in has been screened and has training? And so you just got to make sure, I'm not saying you don't do it, and it's done all the time, and it's good. I mean, you're bringing in knowledgeable networks. But just make sure that you work to make sure that you keep the risk down and that they have liability insurance. Does that help, Scott?
Todd, I'm just going to jump in on that just because I've always told our members that they have to register that person, because what you're saying is that you could put them on even though they're a non-member, because I thought if a non-member was on the ice now, you're violating the insurance.
No, I think that we, as long as they have liability, Pat, liability insurance, and they can produce a certificate saying we are covered. But as I say, the only hurdle is that they don't have the same training as you require, right? So that's a decision that has to be made by that governing body, and you've made that decision.
Yeah,
you've said so.
Okay, so okay. I think we're safer doing what we're doing then. I guess the other one that I wanted to ask is, actually you wanted to ask, so I'll let you go.
You're up, Frank.
I don't know, what do I want to ask? Oh, the intermissions. A lot of what is covered and not covered in intermissions, because there's some bizarre things that happen in intermissions.
In activities? You know what, there's all kinds of stuff that happens between periods, and we will, if we're asked, we will comment on what should be done to keep them safe. We will comment on some that should not be done. So if it's all beyond the norm, you need to check, is the bottom line. The other question we get all the time are the young kids who go to the NHL games and play during intermissions, no problem. I mean, as long as they're wearing full equipment and they're doing it as a team, it's not a problem, okay? Those are the kinds of things we like to see, okay? Other questions? Okay, I'm almost done, Joe, I promise. These are just some I threw in here, and believe it or not, these are all ones we've been asked about, guys. Bungee jumping, big, huge concerts where you're now out of control of a crowd. Those are the kinds of things we don't take responsibility for. Wood chipping as a fundraiser, okay? No, really. But those are the kinds of things, guys, that come out of the come beyond the norm. And it's just a question that gets asked. But those are that's the type of stuff where you have to say to yourself, hey, you know what, this is could be a high-risk situation. Okay, so really quick now, and I'm finished off. When do you need a certificate of insurance? Does everybody know what a certificate of insurance is, first of all? Anybody not know what a certificate of insurance is? Come on, really? I don't even know what a certificate of insurance is. A certificate of insurance is simply something that proves to whoever's requesting it that we have a certain amount of liability coverage. Okay, so a facility will say, we want proof you have $2 million in liability coverage. I send it to Sasha. Sasha will do up the certificate. You send it into your facility. A lot of contracts ask for certificates. Commonly requested, as I say, by facilities. The one thing you have to watch for, and this is why we ask for contracts, is our hold harmless clauses. And these are clauses that really pass on liability to us for everything. This is a common one. They're all different. It depends on who has written them, and it depends on how they're portrayed within the municipality of the city. But it says it's agreed that the leasor being the facility, will not assume the responsibility for any public claims during the time of rental. Any accident causing bodily damage to any member of the leasee's organization, us, your players, your coaches, your trainers, shall be the sole responsibility of us. So end of the day, if the roof of the building falls in, something we have absolutely no control over, and we get hurt, or there's damage, or there's public liability, then you know what? It comes back on us. Because we signed a hold harmless clause saying we were taking responsibility for everything that happens in the building. So what we do is we try to add a statement at the end that says, except claims arising from the negligence or intentional acts or omissions of the leasor, so the facility, and those for whom they are responsible at law. So everyone from those who run the facility to the municipality to anyone who has a responsibility beyond ours to keep that facility safe. Quite often that rectifies the problem. We have huge challenges in getting this accepted. Some municipalities will work with us back and forth and come up with a wording that works for both. But the reciprocal part of a hold harmless clause is really, really, really important. And I sit around the Canadian Recreation Facilities Council table, and we have talked about this. We had both insurers out one year, their insurers and our insurers, and sat around the table and to try to come up with a solution, but it's really the responsibility of each municipality and each town, if you will. So, yeah.
So what are the associations to do if they can't get the facility unless they sign it?
You know what? And I'll be really honest here, guys. If we can't get a change, then we're not going to keep kids off the ice. That's not the intent. What we try to do is work with the city, the town. Quite often they'll say, well, we can't do it now. It's got to go through our risk management committee. So we'll say, okay. And we put it aside and we stay in contact with them and we work towards change. And that's what it is, folks. So.
In the same vein, at the end of the day, if something did happen that's wholly the responsibility of the facility, the insurance companies are going to subrogate anyway, and they're going to fight it.
They're going to subrogate. Okay. You're right. But the more we can get this to happen, the more protected we are. But you're right, and you make a good point. We're not going to keep kids off the ice because of that's not the intent. The intent is to reduce that risk as much as we can. Yeah. You're done.
I think to support Harry's question, being from one of the associations as opposed to a member partner,
yeah.
Could we get something in writing down through the member partners to each of the associations that clearly identifies the wordings for us to take back to our municipalities? You know, I know they have a save and hold harmless clause. I actually believe ours includes the latter. Okay. I'm now going to go back and double check specifically because I'm normally picky on that stuff. But it would be nice to know that we legally have the correct wording, or at least what wording we should be pushing for to represent ourselves. So that's important because I think most associations that aren't fortunate enough to have staff won't have a clue.
So
right?
That is in the Safety Requires Teamwork book. There is an actual clause there with an example of that within the clause. So if you go onto our website, and certainly we can send that link. I can send that link anywhere you want, but it's there. You go into Safety Requires Teamwork on the Hockey Canada website. It's probably on the OHF website too, eh, Phil? I'm not sure, but. Certainly I can do that through the member partners and through Sue and Phil. So
we'll take it upon the OHF to work with you to create a communication out specific to the Hold Harmless Clause and the wording.
And we actually have a template contract out of Alberta that was done several years ago that's kind of that perfect contract. And we don't expect, you know, that many facilities will take it because they all have their own contract needs. But it gives them a really good idea of these are the responsibilities of the user, these are the responsibilities of the facility. So I can send that to you as well, Phil. I got to finish up here, guys, because I think I've gone a little bit over. But so contracts, review them quickly. Don't take on more responsibility than you're required to take on. And the key is, if you're unsure, ask. Okay? If you're in a minor hockey association, if you have a lawyer involved with your executive or somewhere that you can ask the question. Okay, that's the key. Make sure you know what you're signing. I think I'm done.